Hello and welcome to the DrChrono podcast. I'm your host, Oleg Kujikov, and today I'm talking with CEO and co-founder of Stitch Health, Bharat Kilaru. Bharat is a Harvard grad who's been the CEO of two companies at the age of 29. He joins me to discuss communication in business, teamwork, and simplifying healthcare. We also talk about technology and using the right tools for the job, which is quickly becoming a theme on the podcast. I hope you enjoy this talk as much as I did, and without further ado, my interview with Bharat. Hello and welcome to the DrChrono podcast. Today I have the pleasure of welcoming on Bharat Kilaru. He is the CEO and co-founder of Stitch. Bharat, how you doing?
Good. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no problem. So before we talk about Stitch, I just wanted to ask you a little bit about your history in healthcare. So do you want to tell me what you've done sort of before co-founding Stitch?
Sure. So out of college, I ran a organization that was dedicated towards putting together publications and journals around science policy. And that was kind of my first kind of foray into business and healthcare. And there had a chance to write, edit, and manage the editorial process around articles that were talking about, you know, anything from, you know, science policy and economics to healthcare initiatives that were happening locally and internationally. And that was kind of my first jump into that space. After college, had a chance to actually work at and then later run a primary care clinic that was dedicated towards helping low-income and underserved patients in a free clinic capacity. And there had a chance to work with an interdisciplinary team of physicians, nurses, social workers, pharmacists, et cetera, and really help sort of work on this a challenging group of individuals and work towards helping them access care better and kind of holistically deliver a better experience for them.
Huh. So did you kind of learn any lessons that sort of pushed you to start Stitch from that position?
More than a few, I'm sure. Probably the first was just how broken the technology in the healthcare space was. That really came firsthand experience working with both providers and with patients, kind of understanding how difficult it was to really try to deliver the kind of care that we had imagined, whether it was working together or trying to communicate and coordinate with patients. And then plenty of lessons in terms of, you know, both personally and professionally in terms of what, you know, kind of figuring out what I wanted to do with my life and my time.
So you mentioned coordinating care, and I think that's a great jumping point for Stitch. So do you want to tell me kind of what your business does? Maybe like give me your elevator pitch?
Yeah, sure. So Stitch is a patient engagement platform built to empower healthcare providers to deliver great patient experiences. And so what that means is that we build a suite of different tools that help healthcare teams bring providers together and then communicate with those patients. And then sometimes in simplest terms, it can be really for them focused on having a great app that they can use to manage their patient relationships and then send messages, send files, share tasks, send forms, do video conferences with their patients, and an app for patients to sort of experience that end of the clinic as well. And often if you talk to, whether it's you or other people that you might know, if you talk about sort of what the great patient experiences that you might have had, where often you'll hear how technology is often at the center of them, but that technology is not often either used or easily available for so many clinics and healthcare organizations around the country. And so what we do is build software to really allow them to have the access to that.
So what makes that like technology hard to access?
Mostly that it's, I think, hard to put together. I often draw the analogy to technology companies. And at a tech company, there's an entire engineering team dedicated towards building the software layer of the experience that that tech company wants to give customers. But for healthcare organizations, beyond the actual care that they're delivering and their expertise as providers, it's not easy to put together, let's say, not just something as simple as a website for that healthcare organization, but also, let's say, an application to allow them to send messages and share content back and forth with patients or with each other. And so that's usually what makes it difficult for providers to access that.
Right. I know at DrChrono, we work with a lot of smaller to medium-sized practices, helping them automate kind of their business and take care of the things that they can't really afford to do that a larger practice could do. You know, you mentioned like a IT department. Well, a smaller practice can't really hire an IT department to work on their server.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So getting technology into the hands of those smaller, medium-sized practices is so valuable.
Yep. And DrChrono tends to be more the exception than the rule when it comes to the kind of technology healthcare organizations are often using in terms of, you know, having an electronic health record or other tools and softwares, a software that works really well for them, let alone working well, let's say, on mobile and other devices and the kind of things that, you know, individuals in the tech industry are so accustomed to.
Right. And so this this partnership between DrChrono and Stitch is actually relatively new. Do you want to tell me how that came to be, maybe why you chose DrChrono as a partner?
Yeah, absolutely. So on our end with Stitch, we have been building a pretty robust and deep messaging layer that helps providers communicate to one another or communicate with their patients. Having done that and really taking cues from other great companies that have done this across other industries, we really wanted to be able to bring in data, information, and integrations from incumbent tools that were in the space. And the electronic health record is a great example. But historically, those integrations that have been done, unfortunately, rather poorly and in a really complex manner, such that it's not very easy to do an integration with an electronic health record for either vendors or for providers. And so when we laid out what we wanted to do for our integration, we realized that we required working with an electronic health record vendor that would be able to allow for an easy access API and really easy to use and manage and navigate webhooks for providers to be able to have a more seamless experience. And DrChrono was absolutely on the short list for the kind of companies that build an experience like that. And while I think that's growing and becoming more and more of a common wave across other electronic health record organizations, it's still a rare thing. And so it's been great being able to build this end-to-end experience with an integration with DrChrono. And what's amazing about it now is that as of going live recently with the partnership, a healthcare provider can either sign up for DrChrono or sign up for Stitch, sign up for the other service as well, and set up an integration by following pretty directed and easy to use steps without having to talk to anyone at either organization to manage that process, which means it doesn't require, you know, a series of calls and long processes and meetings and things like that. It really just is kind of a decision. If you want to bring health record data and information into your communication and workflow with Stitch, it's, you know, as easy as just following a few steps.
Yeah, and I want to get a little bit more into that. So for, say, a user of DrChrono, how easy is it to, like, implement Stitch in your practice?
Yeah, so with Stitch, we really built it kind of with a lot of awareness of the role that the electronic health record plays. And for us, we really wanted to build the kind of tools and services that could sit around the electronic health record without necessarily interfering with the kind of services and work it was doing. So that way people wouldn't feel like they needed a really in-depth or deep integration, or feel like they were buying or purchasing conflicting or competing tools and technology. And so when we think of, when we talk about Stitch, and we think about what it replaces or what it affects in a healthcare organization, we're often talking about replacing things like SMS and phones and faxes and pagers and the surrounding communication infrastructure that is already happening around the electronic health record, and making that piece much more seamless and all in one place. And so when we were thinking about the DrChrono integration, what's really the way it works at the end of the day is such that you use DrChrono and manage, you know, manage your patients and keep documentation and records and the host of things that DrChrono does well. And with Stitch, can bring it in and handle the communication layer. And if and when you decide that you would like to use an integration that can bring in conversational information from the electronic health record, because maybe that would add an extra layer of data or information, you can do that by using the integration.
Yeah. So you mentioned the communication layer, and I want to get a little bit into the history of like what that communication has been like in the past and your sort of vision as a CEO for what it could be. So could you tell me a little bit about the history of communication in healthcare?
Yeah, sure. I'll do, try to do my best there.
I'm sure you have a great experience in it too.
Right. You know, I don't know if it's necessarily a particularly long history in the context of sort of our generation and the previous generation and the work being done in this space, but it's really one focused on the same kind of tools. And I think like the specific tools that are used are often, I think, the benchmarks of what's been happening. And again, coming back to phones, faxes, pagers, stickies, people passing notes, people running down the hall and trying to talk to each other. That's sort of the most common medium of communication. And without, you know, deriding that at all, I mean, I think for good reason, often because those tools are reliable. You know, the reason people use faxes and pagers and what feels like really archaic tech is because that technology is, you know, it works anywhere and everywhere and is often the least common denominator for the kind of communication that happens between individuals. And that applies to, you know, email as well. And so I think where we're seeing other industries move is saying, hey, that those pieces of technology and architecture that can be now replaced with applications that are dedicated to doing that well and that work cross-platform across web and desktop and mobile and can be used to bring that all in one place. And if you look at what's happening in the tech industry with companies from Atlassian to Slack to Microsoft and others, there's, you know, been a huge uptake in being able to bring and consolidate that kind of communication. And in healthcare, I think a lot of that is still missing. And that's only talking amongst sort of the provider-to-provider communication. When you think of provider-to-patient communication, you know, the analogy is really about how have other industries and companies really managed their customer communications. And when you think of companies, again, like Zendesk or even Salesforce or Intercom or several others, they're is again sort of a wave of improvement in how these institutions can handle communication with their customers. But again, in the healthcare industry, that's still really missing. And so I think to do that well, we have found requires a dedicated product and often company and experience really focused on making that and empowering that experience, which is something separate from managing the records and parts of and billing and other parts that often electronic health records or practice management systems do in the healthcare space.
Right. So can you tell me a little bit about why you think communication is so important, maybe not just in healthcare, but in business in general?
Yeah, sure. Definitely a broad question.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, there's I think at first glance, there's some of the obvious points around that being the medium for most of like the relationships that are happening, again, whether in healthcare or in other businesses. But I also think there's a growing trend where often the medium of engagement between individuals is through communication. And, you know, we're often talking about messaging, but this applies to sort of a much larger and broader set of things than just that, including audio calls and video calls, including files. And, you know, even for us, especially in the healthcare space, the way we send forms and handle things like that. And so when you kind of lump all of that together, like that's the entire experience for a customer or for a patient. You know, a patient walks in to a clinic, they're engaging and communicating with the front desk staff. They're then filling out forms that then get shared by the front desk individual to providers and nurses sometimes. They come in and maybe that's where they actually get sort of a checkup or a follow-up or service actually done for them. But after that, the data that's taken from there is, you know, communicated again to other providers and referrals or maybe patient family members, and then has to kind of circle back. And then again is, you know, summarized all over from, again, back to the patient. And then they're sort of trying to schedule follow-up appointments and bookings. And so all of those are communication interactions. And I think there are plenty of analogies to other businesses, and often different businesses will work slightly differently, but you know, the medium tends to kind of cover a lot. The communication happens through across a lot of different mediums. And so to be able to do that better is always, I think, a massive sort of stepping stone and time point for any industry. And to try to, I think, replace what is now being done through, again, phones and calls and faxes, pagers and emails, et cetera, with a more robust digital medium, I think means a lot for a space that relies so much on that when working with its customers.
Yeah, I think you make a really good point about how communication occurs at all these different levels. Like for the patient, when they come in, you know, they're communicating verbally with the front desk, but then they're also communicating just as much when they're filling out those forms. They're kind of communicating, you know, what's wrong with me? How am I feeling today? And then they're communicating with their nurses and their doctors. And this occurs at like a bunch of different levels. So you could kind of say communication is everything. I also think the cross-platform aspect is so important. I mean, to be limited, I find like I kind of like Slack over maybe text, just because I'm able to bring in like more forms of communication. You know, sharing words is kind of limited. You're actually just writing and reading, and when you're kind of communicating across something like a platform, you can actually bring in, you know, images, files, GIFs, and I find that makes it gives depth to the communication.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely. That's, I think Slack's a great example in terms of what it can do to an industry in terms of making communication work better. And I think the point around cross-platform, I think some of that is recognizing that that's what people are already using and they're experiencing. You know, even though we're saying that we can do things better than email and text, et cetera, those services, they work across different platforms and they're available everywhere and anywhere. And so I think if you want to do something that improves upon that, you certainly have to be able to, at minimum, match that experience and availability. And then I think you get all the other benefits, like you mentioned, the depth that can come with something like a more robust messaging that may not be available if, you know, people are trying to call in or just send emails. And so there's also, I think, other elements that come along with that, whether that's the real-time nature of those experiences or even the asynchronous nature of those experiences, being able to, you know, send messages to someone a note that they'll get back to you later. And, you know, that's a big thing in the healthcare space as well, especially when people are trying to, you know, providers are talking to each other through phone calls, or providers and patients are trying to engage with each other through phone calls. That's not always an easy experience, as you can imagine, if in terms of, you know, people having to stop what they're doing. And so these are the kind of, I think, benefits that come from being able to just run on a more empowered medium than what people are currently using. And with all of that, I think comes the big added advantage of having it all in one place means that you can consolidate that information, you can search through that information, you can access that data more easily. And so with us, I think a big thing that we focus on and we see a lot of people benefit from is just the sheer organizational power of having that communication in one centralized place.
Right, right. Having all that information in one place is so important. I mean, I know, DrChrono is a technology company, and I know that when I'm working on a project, I can kind of count on having everything in one place. Like if someone shared a document with me, it's right next to, you know, where they were giving me instructions. And like you mentioned phone calls, those kind of actually get lost in translation. You kind of have, you forget sometimes what happened on the phone call because it's not like recorded in the Slack.
And I think the next, I was just gonna say, there may be an era that comes next, which is being able then to introduce automated workflows and bots and, you know, while has often been done maybe poorly at times, can be done really well to the effect of being able to really help facilitate the communication in big ways. And so I think, you know, that may be where things go from here.
Yeah. So I want to just back up a little bit since we were on the topic of Slack, seeing as that's kind of the big elephant in the room. Could you tell me like what makes you guys different from another popular messaging service like Slack?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we've been in the press labeled as sort of a Slack for healthcare. But in reality, it might be kind of a far off comparison only because I think what Slack and Microsoft Teams and several of these other services are doing incredibly well is team communication, which means letting people kind of come in and create different, you know, channels or groups and being able to communicate in those and then with each other one-to-one. What we're doing at Stitch is building a patient platform and letting providers either add to that or then send messages to those patients. And so that's sort of the, you know, difference might be one thing, but I think it's kind of, that's where kind of it becomes more apples and oranges. And I think we work with, you know, some forward leading, even healthcare teams that are using Slack and using it to manage their team communication, but are looking for the patient communication and the patient relationship management part of it. And I think that's sort of where the divide is. And so if people want to be able to send messages to their patients or send forms out to their patients or schedule video appointments with their patients, or let's say share notes and files across those patients to each one another as providers, that relationship management piece is what Stitch is all about. And so I think that's sort of where the big gap is. But the Slack healthcare comparison, I think, maybe comes from the place also that we're working really on bringing that kind of robust messaging and file sharing and that, you know, depth of communication that I think they and others have done so well, and trying to bring that to the healthcare space.
Right. So tell me if I'm getting this right. So while Slack is focused primarily on internal communication, and it does that very well, you guys are focused on both internal, you know, inside your practice communication and kind of external patient engagement.
Yeah, I think that's, in fact, I would probably say, like, I think what they're focusing on internal, I think, team communication. We're focusing on patient-centric and patient relationship management, patient-centric communication and patient relationship management. And that piece, I think, is pretty different than the internal communication piece.
Which you guys do as well.
So I think the way we do that specifically is that we handle that through patient-centric messages. For example, let's say, you know, two providers are sharing notes and files about a specific patient, and then they want to later send a message to that patient. We consolidate that information all under one patient record.
So that record kind of has all the communication, external and internal.
External and internal, exactly, tied to that patient.
Got it. So you mentioned earlier you were interested in like automating workflows and bots. So can you elaborate on what you meant by that and why automation is key?
Yes, absolutely. So with, I think automation and bots and workflows, these things allow for the communication between individuals, whether it's between provider and provider or provider and patient, to kind of go to the next level and to bring in ways to bring in new information, new data, you know, just new streams that help people run their organization and practices better. And if anything, kind of amplifies what, let's say, a few individuals can do by giving them sort of the power of a lot of individuals in terms of the communication workflows that are happening.
Yeah, I mean, historically, that's the role of technology, right? Is to kind of get tools into the hands of people so that they can do like the work of, say, more than one person. A person with a wagon and a cart can carry much more than, say, a person like four or five people that are all carrying those things by hand.
Sure. Yeah. And I think that, you know, being able to go from just building a better experience from in communication to being able to say that, oh, your communication runs better. And is actually improved as a result of being on our platform. Those are, I think, goals in terms of really executing on our mission and our vision when it comes to this. And to be clear, like a lot of that has historically happened. I don't think those, in many ways, those are that new concepts. Even if you like go like even like decades back, you have like automated phone reminders for appointments and, you know, things like this that are pretty commonplace.
Right.
But in reality, I think that can sort of, that can maybe go to the next level as we bring in more sophisticated tools for communication and maybe go from being able to do something like that to being able to answer patients' questions or help and assist with bringing in, you know, medical information or data into a conversation or make that kind of data available for providers to use as well.
Right. I mean, accessibility is so important. People, like human error always leaks into everything humans do. If you have like a medical emergency and you need a prescription right away, you know, what if it's 2 a.m. and your doctor's asleep? Like, what are you going to do? So that's where kind of automation and bots look interesting. So is that kind of your vision for the future of Stitch?
Definitely agree that I think that part looks interesting. I'm not sure I would put that as like the core tenet by any means of the vision, but I do think they have a role and a place in terms okay. of improving those elements and being able to bring a pretty sophisticated approach to handling communication across the board. It may be a while, I think, before that element can solely replace by any means sort of the value that an individual can bring, but I think it can certainly do a lot to empower that. And often in like small but really meaningful ways, again, an appointment reminder is an incredibly powerful thing. You know, I think being able to let a patient know that how long it will take for a provider to get back to them is a significant and meaningful interaction step for improving that experience. And so when we talk to our customers, the topic and the goal is always around improving their patient experiences and making life easier for the providers. And I think providers often have a notoriously tough job And unfortunately, especially because of the technology, where the technology has makes things, at least their interface and interaction with them, often feels difficult, especially when you talk to individuals about documentation and everything around that. And so when we think about how to introduce a potentially new piece of technology, we're constantly having to evaluate, well, what is this? How is this going to make the lives of providers easier? And how is it going to make their customers, their patients' lives easier and better?
Yeah, I keep laughing because you've mentioned appointment reminders. And I'm thinking back to my first week of work at DrChrono, where they were teaching us the history. And that was actually the original concept for DrChrono, was text reminders, automated text reminders for medical practices.
Yeah, there you go.
That was kind of the seed. And any kind of, you know, any kind of little change to make a provider's life easier can really grow into something substantial. So I couldn't help but chuckle when you mentioned that.
Agreed. And I think in many ways, that's really like the vision and mission of what we're doing, which is that, you know, there's a, and for a long time now, kind of a growing wave of consumerization in the healthcare space. And while that can have a lot of different meanings, in our context specifically, it means that customers, you know, who are potential future patients or existing patients, are looking and evaluating their experience with healthcare organizations and teams more and more. And so the healthcare teams and organizations, they're trying to respond by delivering that better experience. And so whether it's, you know, a small example like a patient reminder, or something potentially a lot larger, like, you know, an entire application or for a patient, there is sort of a, or even something kind of futuristic like the more integrated chat bots, replying and, you know, managing those communication streams. All of that is, you know, dedicated towards, I think, improving the customer experience in the space.
Right. Well, you just hit on a lot of really interesting themes. I mean, since MACRA and MIPS got passed in 2016, there's been this push towards consumerism in healthcare. And it's slowly but surely being integrated. And, you know, eventually it is hitting at the heart of doctors' wallets, is delivering that best experience. And being able to do that, you know, essentially comes down to the tools that you're using.
Yeah, I agree. And I think, you know, I think the tools are definitely, you know, in an ideal world, they're there to help you manage that part of it and to make it easier for you to do and help, you know, dedicated towards helping you deliver that really great experience. And I think, you know, putting everything else aside, and often the customers that we're talking to, when you get at the heart of, you know, either why they're working as a provider or why they may have started a practice, it's because they had a vision for how, what their ideal patient experience would look like. And when you can, I think, bridge that and kind of help empower that, there's a real sense of excitement that, oh, this is exactly how, you know, I wanted to deliver patient care. This is exactly what I, you know, what I envisioned for what my patients were going to experience. And so I think we're constantly working on and learning what that can be and how that can best be done.
Yeah. So do you have any like success stories that you've heard from, you know, a client of yours since they started using Stitch?
Yeah. You know, more than a few, fortunately, which is nice. And so they kind of range actually, which is, I think, very interesting, from individuals that appreciated the more care coordination aspect of it to individuals that have appreciated the patient communication part of it. And for the individuals that I think appreciated the care coordination aspect of it, being able to bring in conversations and messaging around patients to the workflow has become like a daily and required part of the experience. And I think what that means is that they have integrated Stitch deeply into their day-to-day workflow. And it's a required element for everyone knowing what's going on with different patients. And if it's not there, you know, there's a real sense of, hey, you know, things aren't working here anymore. And we need that to really run and really able to be able to work well. And I think we try to measure the success based on several different things. And we know we've actually made attempts to sort of try to study this metrics and numbers around this in terms of impact, but like trying to evaluate, hey, how did implementing Stitch improve your care coordination? You know, how did it improve your patient wait times? How did it improve your provider response times? Like, and try to put numbers to this. And while there is sort of a range to that and there's like an art of evaluating that, you know, I think for the most part, it's been incredibly positive in terms of doing that. And I think there's also this really added element of, you know, hey, a lot of the other tech that we have used has historically not been a great experience. And this feels like it was built towards being one. And when you add in layers of, hey, this also works on web and mobile, et cetera, like I think there's a real excitement about that, you know, excitement about the actual technology and about bringing that to the healthcare practice. Something I feel like, you know, Dr. Crono, I'm sure, experiences a lot too, trying to be sort of more cutting edge in terms of what it's offering.
So you talk about the importance of internal communication. And as a former athlete, I can't help but think about like the sports teams I've played on. Mm-hmm. And anyone who's played on a sports team knows that, you know, you can focus all of your efforts on your individual skill, your conditioning, everything. And the parallel there is to a doctor and his education in medical school. But if the communication within the team isn't there, then it doesn't matter how much individual talent is accumulated on the team. I mean, you're going to fail, because when you're not working together, you just can't get the job done at the end of the day. So I can't help but think about that. And I feel like anyone who's played on any kind of team understands that, or even in the workplace, you know, we all know people that are great at communication and people that aren't. So yeah, that internal communication is so important when you're on teams. But you also mentioned the patient engagement. So do you want to get into that a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. So, and just jumping on your point a little bit, I mean, yeah, I mean, absolutely agree. And I think one of the most interesting things is people often have so many kind of preconceptions about what healthcare and medicine is, sort of standing on the outside and looking in. And, you know, often when you think of healthcare, you're like thinking of a doctor. And when you think of where they work, you kind of think of like a large hospital. But so much of healthcare is individuals that aren't doctors, whether that's like nurses or pharmacists or social workers or the front desk staff or the referral staff or the billing team. And then so many healthcare organizations aren't hospitals, but they're maybe like primary care clinics or rehab organizations or PT and physical therapy sites, dentist offices, you know, surgical centers. You know, healthcare covers so much as a word. And these teams and their makeup look so different. But one of the sort of most common elements, at least we have found at Stitch, is that their work in all these environments is centered on patients, and that almost everything they're doing is tied to a patient one way or another. And yeah, so leading into a little bit into the patient engagement part of it, I think what we've seen really excited there has been just people being able to telling us that they're able to develop deeper relationships with patients as a result of using Stitch. And we kind of noticed that even with sort of our earliest products and implementations. Like, we're about to release sort of a revamped and new version of our patient communication and engagement suite. But even in our sort of earliest implementations, we found that there's this incredibly powerfully engaging thing. Oh, now my patient has an app to connect to me on their phone. And I have an app to connect to them on my phone. And there's this like feeling that there's a much deeper link between provider and patient as a result. And the downstream effect of that is that they're talking more and they're building closer relationships. And while that's not immediately obvious as a goal for every healthcare organization, there's a real desire to, you you know, improve engagement from the provider side to patients and improve access from the patient side to the provider for everybody. And kind of creating a really powerful link for that can be a really powerful experience. And if you've ever gone and, or visited or accessed healthcare from, you know, organizations that are already pretty tech leading, they may have given you an experience that's similar to that, where, you know, maybe they had an app for you to access their healthcare or a really great portal, or they like handled communication with you really well. And those are the kind of things I think that can make you leave with a really positive impression of that healthcare organization and experience.
Right, right. Communication is so important. But then so is trust. I mean, and trust kind of comes from good communication. You know, we kind of innately trust our doctors because of their educational background. But sometimes when that communication isn't there, you can have a bad experience and want to change your doctor. So being able to communicate for doctors to patients is so important. And that's really the heart of this conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think consumerization that we talked about is very much at the heart of, you know, me empowering patients to say, hey, I'm looking for the best experience I can find, and I'm, you know, willing to go wherever I need to go get that, and not feeling like locked into only one option. And as a result, I think these healthcare organizations are responding by saying, okay, because consumers are more empowered, we need to start delivering better and better experiences. And not only does that matter to us in terms of the art of practicing, you know, care, but it also matters to us in terms of, you know, our bottom line and revenue as a practice.
So I have a big question for you now. What do you think is the biggest challenge facing healthcare today when it comes to delivering that best patient experience?
I think the biggest challenge is that and to be clear, there are quite a few different challenges, but I think one of the biggest challenges that comes to mind is complexity. And in simplest terms, that it is an incredibly complex experience for patients to access and experience healthcare. And maybe that happens from understanding how your insurance works. Maybe that's from understanding where you can or cannot go to get healthcare. Maybe that comes from, you know, paying the bills and understanding, you know, what that part of the experience is like. Or maybe it's as simple as understanding what it is, you know, you have, what your diagnosis is, or what it is you have to do as a patient to take care of yourself or to get better care. I think sheer amount of complexity in that end-to-end experience, I think, has a huge number of downstream effects that I think kind of has this virtuous cycle of things sort of fueling more and more of that complexity. And it's really hard, I think, for anyone, not just us, but, you know, any either organization or individual or provider or patient to kind of cut through all of that and to deliver a streamlined and simpler experience that people can, you know, walk away with a positive impression with. And so I think, you know, that is at least one of the big elements that has for a long time jumped out to us at Stitch. And so I think that's one of the ones that we're at least working towards trying to improve a little bit. And of course, there's sort of a myriad of other complexities that come with the industry and the space. And I think for patients or providers to understand that it's difficult.
Yeah, I mean, it wouldn't be hard to list what makes this whole experience complicated.
Sure.
Anytime I've gone to a hospital, it's almost always been like a new experience, you know? I broke my collarbone. That was a new experience. I fell snowboarding and I got a fracture in my spine. Don't worry, everybody. I'm okay.
I'm sorry. Both of those sound terrible. I hope you're okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and you're in pain and, you know, doctors are asking you to sit on a cold metal table and do weird body positioning so they can get the right x-ray. And so it's an uncomfortable experience a lot of the times. And so for people going to seeking healthcare, I mean, a prerequisite for that is something's wrong. And I mean, that adds a layer of complexity because you're not in your right headspace.
Absolutely. I think patients are often in, you know, they're often, you know, visiting these experiences in their weakest or most fragile state. And it's hard to process what's happening around you. So yeah, absolutely agree that that adds a tremendous amount to what is already a complicated experience and trying to navigate that.
Right. And that's why simplifying this process at any level is so important.
Agreed.
Yeah. All right. Well, I got one more question for you, Bharat. Mm-hmm. You know, feel free to freestyle on this one, but how did you choose the name Stitch for your business?
Yeah. I wish I could say there was, you know, an incredibly sort of deep evaluation or process to that. But when we were talking about what we were doing in the early days, we were talking about bringing a lot of communication together and into one place, especially in the context of kind of organizing it around a patient. And so at some point or another, you know, we had used the word, you know, stitch to kind of describe stitching that communication together. That word, which also has a lot of historic medical connotation to it as well, felt like a good word to kind of describe what we were doing towards the communication. So I think in some ways that was sort of the inspiration. And after that, I've kind of run with it. And I think customers kind of latched onto it. And so that's what we've been called since.
Great. Well, Bharat, thanks for joining me on the podcast. It was really insightful for me to talk with you. How can listeners connect with you? Where can they find you?
Yep. They can come in. The best way to connect with us is to visit our website, which is stitch.health, or they can just Google Stitch Health and they should be able to find us.
All right, great. Well, thank you for your time. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thanks for having me.